like-minded people talk to like-minded people. By that I mean sports people talk to sports people. More specifically, football people talk to football people. More specifically, Eagles fans talk to Eagles fans. Veterans talk to veterans. More specifically, same branch of service talks to same branch of service. More specifically, where did you serve? What did you do? Animal lovers talk to animal lovers. More specifically, horse people talk to horse people. More specifically, do you ride Western or do you ride English? There's multiple layers of like-minded people in our world. We have foodies, we have your Pinterest people, you have your Facebook people, even in this church, we have Lego masters. In the Bible, prayer is the way that we communicate with God. We're asking His favor, we're praising Him, and we're expressing our gratitude. God clearly, clearly designed us to have relationships with one another. More specifically, God clearly designed us to have a relationship with Him. My goal today is to show us a way that we can talk to Him in His language, using His language. So with that said, let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, it isn't about me, it's about You. Lord, I pray, Lord, if there's one here today that does not know You, Lord, may they give You a chance. May they just open their heart just to hear a little of You. Lord, again, thank You for this opportunity to perhaps shed a little bit of light into their situation, whatever it may be. So again, Lord, may You increase, as Pastor John so well says, may You increase, may I decrease. It's all about You. And it's in Your name we pray. Amen. So, we know from reading our Bibles, we know that your first fill-in is prayer is expected. And how we know that is if you open your Bible to Matthew chapter 6, Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 through 7, Jesus is talking to His followers. Jesus is talking to His followers, and He says this. And He says, "And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room, shut the door, and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you." Verse 7, "And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words." Jesus here, just in this short passage, clearly lays out in 5, 6, and 7, when you pray. Prayer is an expected thing. As a follower of His, I will pray to Him. I will pray to Him. Now, we know that there are three answers to prayer. Yes, no, and not yet. Not yet. Until God answers those prayers, we continue to pray. Or as I say, I'm going to continue down this road, Lord. I'm going to continue down this road until You tell me no. Until You tell me no, I'm going to keep going this same way. Now, He knows, and some of you also know, that I'm a very hard man, so I need a thick wall. So, and I do pray that because I don't want to invest my time, my effort, and you'll hear this later, I don't want to invest my time, my energy into something that's worthless. So until God hears until I hear from Him that I'm going to continue on. We know that His ways are definitely higher than our ways. We know His thoughts are not our thoughts. So in Isaiah, Isaiah 55, 6 and 9, it says something about this. It says this. It says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord and he will have mercy on him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Here it is. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. My thoughts are finite. I can only think as far as the end of my nose, basically. And in my situation, I don't see big picture, okay? And he knows big picture. He knows the whole thing, how he wants it to play out. So go to him. Go to him and ask him, what do you want me to do in this situation? Now, the verse that our deacon of the day quoted, Psalm 145, 18 and 19, gives us a little bit of dial-in as far as how we go to him. How we go to him. It says this, the Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desires of those who fear him. He hears their cry and saves them. So in that, in order for me to go to him in truth, what I need to do is I need to be raw and be real. In the counseling room, I will tell my counselee, if you're coming to me with a fixed situation, you already know the outcome of this situation. You do not want God to fix your situation. Okay? When I go to God with my ick, whatever my ick is, and I already have a plan of how I'm going to work it out, I'm not going to him in truth. I'm just going to so that way he hears my words. I've got to invite him into my situation. So your next fill-in, own my mistakes. Own my mistakes. It is possible that each and every day I will not be a perfect man. And so what I have to do, and what I do, is before I tell people, before I go nighty night, I quote 1 John 1:9. But I'm being real in this. 1 John 1:9 says, If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So I'm one of those persons that, I'm not a book reader. I'm one of those persons I'm a visual person. I learn by seeing things visually. For example, I used to be in construction and I used to tell people that big picture, little words. Really, you just take a picture of what it is you want me to build, and I'll build it. I don't need the blueprints, just big picture. So here's my analogy on forgiveness. This is me. This is all my ick. This is all my junk. This is all the stuff that I did in my day. This is God. This is what he's done. This is what he's done for me. This is what he's done for you. All of his forgiveness, all of his going to the cross, all of his rising from the grave, it's found in here. So forgiveness, in my mind's eye, looks like this. Gone. Gone. When I ask for his forgiveness, it is gone. The only person that gets to go back there is me and my mind. Me and my mind. Okay? When God says you are forgiven, you are forgiven. Now, in that, okay, there are areas in my life that I get so easily tripped up in, and I think that I was done with that. I thought I had that anger part of me under control, and it so easily comes back. And it surprises me sometimes where I get so tripped up into something. Well, there's a really beautiful book called 1 John that calls you, if you're a believer in him, calls us little children, because I behave just like a little child. 1 John 2:1 says this, my little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. I am writing to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven for his name's sake. Now, there's a caveat to that. There is one problem that my God cannot fix. I know, surprise, surprise, but there is one problem my God cannot fix, and that is the one that I refuse to give to him. The one that I hold on to. Do you know what he did to me? Do you know what he said to me? When I hold on to it and I refuse to let that problem go, I have not invited him into that situation. If you have an addiction, if you have, pick a thing, whatever it is, when we don't invite him in to the situation, we are holding on to our little pet. Or as I say, don't decorate your cell. Don't decorate your cell. So there are three sides to every situation. There is my opinion or my truth. There's their opinion or their truth. And then there's his truth. His truth always prevails. John 14:6 says this. Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. God's truth is always right. God's truth is always where we need to land. Doesn't matter how I feel. Doesn't matter how I feel. I didn't clear this with my daughter, but I'm going to use an example with her. So there was one time where she said to me, she said, I don't feel like sweeping the house. And anyway, there are times in my life where I don't feel like doing that either. However, we got to get past the feelings. Just do what he says to do. Do what he says to do. 1 John 5:20 says this, and we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding, so that we may know him who is true. And we are in him who is true, and his Son, Jesus Christ, he is the true God and eternal life. You notice in there three times in one verse, true is mentioned. We've got to get to his truth. Own my mistakes, give them to him, and just let it be there. Psalm 33:4 says this, for the word of the Lord is right, and all his work is done in truth. I've got to be raw, I've got to be real with him. I don't have all the answers. He does. So give it to him. Give it to him. Matthew 11, 28 through 30 says this, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. If you remember the way I started off, I said, like-minded people talk to like-minded people. Well, there's an other side to that. Worrywarts talk to worrywarts. Anxious people talk to anxious people. People with gambling addictions talk to people that love to gamble. And so we can go down the wrong road. And we can go down the wrong road because we haven't invited him into the situation. And please hear my heart on that. Okay, I used to work with a man, and I worked with him. Never knew that he had an addiction problem to gambling. And we, at that particular time, we were going through Atlantic City, and we stopped in Atlantic City to get a meal. And across the street was the casino. And he walked across the street, and he start. He just started to stutter like crazy. And I'd never seen that in him all my life. I worked alongside of him for about 3 years at that time, and I was amazed at how the gambling addiction just drew him in. I remember some of his stuttered words were, "I really shouldn't. I really shouldn't." So if a person has an addiction, you got to understand, you got to come alongside of them. I have to come alongside of them and understand exactly where they're coming from. So back to myself, how do I get myself to speak to God a little bit better, speak his language? I call these alignment prayers. There is many found in your Bible. I just chose a few for today's message, alignment prayers. The first one was the one we did in VBS here a couple years ago. It says, make me to know your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. What I say by alignment prayers, it's spiritually aligning myself in the process of his thoughts, his words, and what does his truth say about the situation? I'm aligning my thoughts, my words, and my action with his truth. That's what I'm doing. When I say alignment prayer, I'm using his word to align myself to be right with him. Here's one that I've been using for years. I love this one because there's only one person in this world that I can change, and that's this guy right here. It's Psalm 139, 23, 24. It says this, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there's any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. If I want to live a frustrated life, I want to change person X or person Y, or situation X or situation Y. If I want to live a frustrated life, that's what I'll do. If I want to live a fulfilling life, this person needs to change. The person in the mirror is the person that needs to change. So I'm asking God, Lord, you search me. Search me, God. Know my heart. Is it right? Is it right in your eyes? Try me. Are my thoughts exactly what you, would you give an amen to my thoughts? Would you say, well done? Or see if there's any, so I'm going to do this thing, but I actually have an agenda for doing that thing for that person. If there's any grievous way in me. And then finally, after that, Lord, how about you lead? You lead. I'm glad being second. You lead. James 1:5. I use this in my time. So I retired, and so therefore I have 24 hours of freedom. One would think that. James 1:5 says this, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God who gives generously to all and without reproach, and it will be given to him. So what I'll do is someone asked me to do whatever it is. I'll say, Lord, you give me wisdom. Your word, right there at the end of the verse, it says, the wisdom will be given to him. So is this something, Lord, that you want me to invest your time in? Is this something that you want, you would say yes to investing my time in that? Or even yet, my money. It's not my money. It came through his hands first. So, Lord, this is your money. This is your time. Lord, what do you want me to do here? You promised me that you'll give me wisdom. So, Lord, I'm praying it back to you. I'm praying it back to you. If I lack wisdom, you say that you're going to give me right wisdom. Psalm 86:11. Teach me your way, Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. In this, teach me your way, Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Again, back to three sides to every situation. My opinion, my truth, their opinion, their truth, his truth. I want to be in his truth. Again, these are all alignment prayers that I will pray these back to God. Lord, it's why reinvent the wheel? They're already in your Bible. Psalm 119:27 says this, make me understand the way of your precepts, and I will meditate on your wondrous works. Meditate. I'm going to use that word. I want to hone in on meditate. What does meditate look like? Well, it's explained in Joshua 1:8. Joshua 1:8 says this, This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it, and then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. In other words, what God is saying, spend time with me. Spend time with me in the morning. Spend time with me in the day. Spend time with me in the evening. And then you'll learn exactly what I want you to do. Spend time with me. Meditate in his word. Joshua just spent 40 years in the wilderness with a whole bunch of naysayers. And so Joshua and Caleb, by the way, after Jesus, I definitely want to meet Joshua and Caleb. I want to learn how they did that. Spend 40 years. Think about that. 40 years in the wilderness with a whole bunch of naysayers. And I'm sure Joshua and Caleb got to dig the grave for so many people that said, God can't do it. So, here's my question. Do you want to be in the wilderness or do you want to live in the promised land? Spend time in his word. Meditate in his word. Stay there. Okay, moving on. Specific prayer. By that I mean, what do you want God to do for you? Colossians 4:2 says this, continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. Notice that word, watchful. So you lay a request at his feet. Now, what's he going to do with it? A couple weeks ago, Pastor John wasn't feeling well. We had an elder meeting on a Tuesday, and so much so, Pastor John didn't know how, what was going on with his body or whatever. So we did the social distant thing for our elder meeting. The following day, Wednesday, he was supposed to speak Wednesday night, but still no voice. So he had someone else lead for him on Wednesday night. I caught on to this, and I started praying for Pastor John because Pastor John needs his voice to be up here on a Sunday morning. So I was very specific in my prayer about Pastor John being up here to be able to speak on that particular Sunday morning. So I was very watchful in my prayer to make sure that God heard exactly what I wanted to happen. Be specific when you pray. Here's a story from the New Testament that happened. This is Jesus' first miracle. And it says this. It says, on the third day, there was a wedding at Cana in Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus was also invited to the wedding with his disciples. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, they have no wine. And Jesus said to her, woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come. His mother said to the servants, do whatever he tells you to do. First of all, do you see her specific prayer request? They have no wine. Now, did you notice at the end of verse 5 what she's doing? She's letting it at his feet. She says, do whatever he tells you. In other words, Lord, not my will. I think you may have heard these words from Jesus later on. Not my will, Lord, but your will be done. And that's exactly what Mary did here. She gave the request, and then what she did was she let it there. She let it there. So when I pray, am I specific about what I want God to do? Or do I pray like those general prayers, like bless me? A little kind of funny story, if you will. Approximately 10 years ago, my father-in-law had a stroke, left side totally paralyzed. And he had asked me to, when I come down, they lived in Virginia, when I come down to put handrails along the stairs. And when we went down, we put the handrails along the stairs, but I prayed this general prayer. By the way, don't do this, but here it is. So anyway, I said, Lord, I don't I don't know his world, so show me. Well, guess what? 2 months later, I got to break my arm. I found out pretty quickly exactly what he means, what it is when you lose, if you will, one function, one side of your body that does not function. Anyway, don't play breast me. It's just not a good thing to do. So when what do you want God to do for you? Could you express it in clear and certain terms? Am I so clear on what I want God to do? Could I write it on a piece of paper? And not that you would need to do this, but could I submit it to him as an official request? So my suggestion is, sometimes I do this. I'll think about my request, and then I'll go, well, maybe I'm not as specific as what I really want him to do for me. And so when we are specific in our prayer request, now we know without the shadow of a doubt, he answered our prayer. He answered our prayer. Then you get to give him some sugar. Matthew 7:7 through 8 says this, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and it will be opened to you, for everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, it will be opened. Okay, so I'm going to go back in time. Actually, 27 years ago, I had a specific prayer request. So I was a single man. And I'm looking for a godly wife, but I'm a single man. So there's a lot of really good-looking girls out there. There's a lot of good talkers out there. But I don't want a good-looking, and I don't want a good talker, okay? What I want is and this is a serious thing, I want her to love God more than what she loves me. And ladies, if you're out there looking, I would want you to put, for that man to put God before you. There's a reason. There's a reason. Because, see, I already know that the storms are coming. So, if she puts God before me, when I mess up, and I do mess up quite often, okay? When I mess up, she's not going to point her finger at me. She's going to take her issue to him. When she messes up, okay, because we're human, okay, we're going to mess up. Both of us are going to go this way. If I believe that God is number one, she believes that God is number one, we are taking our issues this way. And you see what happens when we do this, okay? When we take our issues this way, not only do we draw closer to each other, but we draw closer to God. 2 Corinthians 6:14 through 17 has something to say about who I marry. It says this, do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial? Or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. God's word is very clear. Make sure that if you're going to marry, if you're thinking long term, make sure that they know the Lord. Because I tell you, if they do not know the Lord, they are going to rely on their own beliefs and their own resources, and that never ends well. Ruth Graham says this, a happy marriage is the union of two good forgivers. A happy marriage is the union of two good forgivers. Again, we are human, okay? I'm going to mess up. She's going to mess up. But when we love the Lord, we have a common goal. We want to please the Lord. Okay, next point. Thank him. As soon as possible, thank him. If God has done something for you, thank him as soon as possible. And I'll take it a step further. Tell others. Just the other day, something happened in my world, and I was so like full of it. I had to pick up the phone, and I had to call some of my friends and say, hey, guess what God just did? Thank him for what he's done. Thank him for what he's done. There's a story you'll find it in the New Testament in Luke chapter 17. And it's verse 11 through 19. It says, now as it happened, as he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Then, as he entered a certain village, there met him 10 men who were lepers, who stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices, and they said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. So when he saw them, he said to them, go show yourselves to the priest. And so it was, as they went, they're cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, returned and with a loud voice glorified God. And he fell down on his face at his feet, and he glorified God. And he gave thanks, and he was a Samaritan. So Jesus answered and said, were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? Were there not any found to return to give glory except this foreigner? And he said to him, arise, go your way, your faith has made you well. Translation in that, count your blessings. Count your blessings. It's a song that I used to sing as a child. I remember growing up in church, and it was count your blessings. So it says in that song, it says, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. You know, in every situation that we are in, yes, it might be rough, it might be hard. I don't want to discount that, but don't forget the blessings that are over here. I think if you find out, if you write your problem down and you write your blessings down, your blessings will far outweigh your problem. Psalm 23:1, David had something to say about this. He says this, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Now, I deliberately read it just like that. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Most of you know the rest of it. Let's just stop there. Stop there for a second. What if we said, the Lord is my shepherd? Oh, yes, he is. The Lord is the one that, yes, he is. He's my shepherd. I'm a child of his. I'm a child of his. Oh, you think you got one over on me? That's fine. You got one over on me. But I got a newsflash for you. I have a big daddy, and he carries a big stick. So, yep, the Lord is my shepherd. I'll let him handle you, and I'll press on. 1 Thessalonians 5:16 says this, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Always give him some sugar. I can't tell you how, I don't know, when I get there, I presume I'll get my answer to this, but I'm a firm believer that if I brag on him, he gives me more. If I brag on him, he gives me more. I've seen it so many times in my life where, thank you, Lord, and then next thing you know, here comes another one. I just got to thank him. I have to. James 1, 2, and 3 says this, count it all joys, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. It's kind of an odd word to start off, you know, trials. Count them. Count them? For real? Did you know that you may be invited to a lot of arguments? That doesn't mean you need to attend them. Okay? So when God gives you the stamina, the wherewithal to say, you know what, I'm not going to get involved in that conversation. I'm not going to go down that road. Count them. Lord, thank you that I did not get involved in that conversation. That was not going to go anywhere good. So, Lord, thank you. Thank you, seriously, that you gave me enough wherewithal, enough stamina within myself to walk away. There is so much power to walking away from a negative conversation. Just go. Let it. Philippians 4, 6 and 7 says this, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God," oh my, there's so much there, "and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and mind in Christ Jesus." The peace of God. When you know that you're a child of His, when you know that He's got you, yes, it might be tough, it might be rough, it might look terrible, but when you know that you're a child of His and He genuinely has your best interest. The only way that, in the Olympics, the person that gets the gold medal is the one that lifted the heaviest, okay? And God's going to give you the strength to do that. Colossians 3:17. I use this one often in the work environment. "And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him." Lord, thank You, seriously. Thank You for giving me hands and feet to be able to work for You. Seriously, thank You, Lord, that at this moment, You've given me the physical capabilities that I can do something for You, that You'll get glorified out of it. So we covered basically my prayer life, how I work my prayer life. So I aligned myself with Him. I was specific in what I wanted Him to do. And in all that, I'm thankful. So we have to realize who we're talking to. Okay? We have to realize when we go to Him, who is this man or who is this God that we're going to? Well, I wrote it out. He was the greatest man in history. He had no degree, yet they called Him teacher. He had no medicines, yet they called Him healer. He had no army, yet kings feared Him. He won no military battles, yet He conquered the world. He committed no crime, yet they crucified Him. He was buried in a tomb, and He lives on today. His name is Jesus, and He's waiting to hear from you. He knows, He sees, He cares. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, I just say thank You. Thank You, Lord, that You have called me to be a child of Yours. Lord, and I thank You for Your word and how it just fits. It fits any and all situations, no matter. Lord, please forgive us. Please forgive me for holding on to things, Lord, that just need to be let go and placed into Your hands. Help us to see You, help us to seek You throughout our days. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.